This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Good morning, friends. Welcome to worship with St. John's. Welcome to you in the sanctuary. Welcome to you online. And a special welcome to guests who are here with us on this day. We've come for this hour of worship to be renewed with the healing love of Jesus Christ. And coming for worship helps us to be the church all week long. This is week 5 in our series, Famous Johns. Over 7 weeks, we're meeting some famous Johns throughout history as we read through the Gospel of John. In our scripture reading for today, we'll hear 2 stories of Jesus' healing power. A few announcements in our life together. After worship, you're invited to participate in our Hunger Mission Project. We'll be in the sanctuary packing 25,000 meals for Kids Against Hunger. We need dozens and dozens of mission workers to help us in that project. So you can find your place with us and be a part of that up to 2 hours of time or as much as you can give us if you'd like. You can also help donate to purchase the food. There's an offering basket in the gathering area. Just drop your offering gift in there. Our offering budget covers a lot of the cost of the meal, but we need to raise about $800 to cover the rest of it. In total, it's over $4,000 to purchase all the food that we'll package today. So join us if you're able for that today. For the month of February, we're having a special collection for the Care Closet, making a little bit of a competition, just like with the Super Bowl coming up. So it's sweet versus salty, granola bars, those kind of sweet treats, and then salty snack crackers. You'll find the bins out in the gathering area all month long. You can bring your vote for sweet versus salty. I'm going for sweet all the way.
Salty.
And you can vote with your gift in those bins to the Care Closet. It all just goes straight to the Care Closet right here in town. Next Saturday evening is our potluck and bunco game night. Come for an evening of fun and friendship and fellowship as we share a meal and then play the game. If you can roll dice, you can play bunco. It's a lot of fun. Great for people of all ages. Our next new member orientation is set for next Sunday, February 13th at 1 p.m. In that 2-hour block of time, we'll get to know each other and consider the mission of the church and of this congregation. If you'd like to come, just talk to me or Becca Polk or contact the church office. We'd love to have you if it's for you or someone you know. Our Soggy Prairie concert has been rescheduled. The date we've got is Saturday, March 19th. It's a 7 o'clock concert with a 6 o'clock meal. And just talk to the church office for tickets, and you can still get into the meal if you'd like to for that. So March 19th, that's the date. And students are free to the concert, that's 18 and under, and they have a reduced price for the meal as well. Hope you can join us on March 19th. In stewardship news, we have met our 22 Simply Giving Challenge, so you can stop hearing about it from me for now, which is great. Our goal was 22, and we got 33 new and increased commitments to Simply Giving, which is awesome. So on Monday morning, we'll have a drawing for those Brewers tickets. So stay tuned if you're one of those 33 households. Of course, you can join Simply Giving at any time. It provides consistent income to the church, consistent generosity for the giver. And more scholarship or more stewardship news. We met our scholarship challenge. We gave $100,000, folks, in the course of 3 months to make a $250,000 endowment, an investment in the youth of this congregation. So praise God for that. Super exciting. Absolutely. Thanks for your prayers and support and your generosity to make that happen. Really exciting for the youth and students of this congregation. The Blue Epistle has other announcements, events, prayers in our life together. Also see your St. John's email news and find your way to connect in with our church. We will celebrate Holy Communion together today. At that time, come forward with your hand open to receive the bread. We also have gluten-free bread available. And then receive the cup of wine or juice before continuing back to your seat. An empty basket at the end of the front row is for your empty cup. All are welcome to participate in that holy meal. If you would rather, come forward and cross your arms to receive a blessing. If you're worshiping with us online, we invite you also to have a form of bread and wine or juice available for that holy meal. We'll have a prayer leader available in the gathering area if you'd like to pray with someone one-on-one during Holy Communion. invite you to please rise for a time of confession. We gather in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, Jesus shows us all the ways that we fall short. He also provides a way out of the holes we dig ourselves into. Forgive us our sins and show us how to make better choices and to be better friends, parents, kids, partners, and co-workers. Let Christ's light shine through us. For the sake of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Jesus does indeed forgive. Jesus cleanses us of our sin and recreates us in God's image. Receive the entire forgiveness of all your sins. Go and walk free of guilt, shame, and sin. You are made new in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We sing, Bless the Lord.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We read together from Psalm 40. I waited patiently upon the Lord,
who stooped to me and heard my cry.
The Lord lifted me out of the desolate pit, out of the miry clay,
and set my feet upon a high cliff, making my footing sure.
The Lord put a new song in my mouth and a song of praise to our God.
Many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in the Lord.
Happy are they who trust in the Lord.
They do not turn to enemies or to those who follow lies.
Great are the wonders you have done, O Lord my God. In your plans for us, none can be compared with you.
Oh, that I could make them known and tell them, but they are more than I can count.
Let us join together in prayer. Great and gracious God,
by your power, our Lord Jesus healed the sick and gave new hope to the hopeless. Though we cannot command or possess your power, we pray for those who want to be healed. Mend their wounds, soothe fevered brows, and make broken people whole again. Help us welcome every healing as a sign that, though death is against us, you are for us, and have promised renewed and risen life in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you to please be seated. And we call on Denise Pace for our mission and ministry moment.
My name is Denise Pace. When Pastor Matt asked me to speak this weekend, he said, I wouldn't be expecting some miracle testimony, but rather what faith looks like on your journey. For anyone who doesn't already know, I have a connective tissue disease that affects every aspect of my body. It is debilitating and there is no cure. So to be honest, faith has been a roller coaster. Faith has been really amazing and loud and cheerful. It has come in forms of supportive friends and family, doctors and nursing staff who have kept searching for answers, many procedures and 42 surgeries to fix each part of my body. Also, amazing adventures with my wonderful partner and children. But faith has also been absent, quiet, lost in any type of connection. It has been sleepless nights thinking about suicide and praying to not wake up. It has led to so many tears and many days of giving up. Faith is hard for everyone. Faith is especially hard, especially difficult when referring to healing that you know will only happen with a miracle. We don't hear about miracles happening nowadays as they are spoken about in the Bible. In today's scripture, you will hear a story of two healings that Jesus gave. Jesus states in John chapter 4, verse 48, "Unless you people see signs and wonders, you will never believe." However, the actual definition of faith is complete trust or confidence in someone or something. It doesn't say complete trust when I see evidence. Keeping my faith through these several years has gone back and forth. I'm not sitting up here to tell you that to just have faith and believe that everything happens for a reason or that God only gives us what we can handle. Those are my least two favorite things to hear someone say. I'm here to tell you that it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to have your faith falter. If I told you anything different than that, I would be a liar and a hypocrite. What I can share with you is when I have been at my lowest and felt that I had lost my faith and was angry with religion and God, and when I gave up, I had never been more depressed, lonely, or lost. It's really hard to find the good in your life when your life contains so much pain and no end in sight, but I promise if you choose faith and lean on God and your beliefs, you won't walk alone. I find it's best to talk about it with others in similar situations. Talk to God, even yell at God if you must. The deeper you allow and strive for your faith to grow, the longer you'll be able to keep your head above water. I still have really awful times in my life when I almost give up. In fact, I did just this last week. But I don't. There is no logical reason why I don't give up. I mean, to be honest, I have enough medications at home to take out several people. The only thing I can think of is it has to be my faith. It has to be God's presence working through those around me to keep me on track. So I'm going to leave you today with some tips. Tip number one, don't let anyone minimize your pain or fear by telling you that someone out there has it worse off. There is always someone out there with it worse, but that doesn't mean that your feelings aren't valid. Second, find someone, anyone you can talk with, and I mean really talk with, someone who won't judge, someone who maybe is in a similar boat as you. You can even reach out to me, but just talk. Get it out. Know that it is okay to be angry. It is okay to be sad. When you are dealing with health issues or something that has caused you to not be able to do things you once could do or would have liked to do, it is a grieving process. Just like death, it is difficult to let go of our hopes and dreams. Finally, tip number three, find your faith tribe. Find people who will pray for you and help remind you that God will always be by your side, even if at times it doesn't feel like it. God didn't do this to you because of something you have done. You are not being punished. Who knows why we go through what we go through? That is not ours to figure out. Keep your faith and hold it tight, because sometimes it's the last string on your fraying rope.
Our scripture reading for today is from the Gospel of John, two stories of Jesus' healing. These are the first stories of Jesus' healing that we hear in the Gospel of John. Up to this point, Jesus had done miracles, like turning water into wine. That was his first sign. So we've heard that Jesus is a miracle worker. Jesus had cleansed the temple from corruption. So we've heard that Jesus frees us from sin and oppression. Jesus had captivated crowds and individuals like Nicodemus and the woman at the well. So we've heard that Jesus is our Savior and Messiah who loves us all. And this brings us to our scripture reading for today. And we're going to hear that Jesus is a healer. Jesus did quite a bit of traveling in his days, and a little geography can help us to better understand the stories. Jesus was in Jerusalem, in the region of Judea, for the Passover festival. That's where he cleansed the temple and met with Nicodemus. Then he went north, passed through Samaria. That's where he met with the woman at the well. And now he's continued north again to his home region of Galilee. First, we're going to hear a royal official who came from Capernaum to Cana for healing for his son. Cana and Capernaum are two towns in Galilee, about 25 miles apart. So back then, it would have taken a couple days to travel between them. Later in our reading, we'll hear how Jesus went back down to Jerusalem for a festival in Jerusalem. He went there to a public park with a pool that was believed to have healing powers for the first person to enter the pool after an angel stirred the water. The park was full of people who were blind, lame, and paralyzed. Our readers can come forward and invite you to turn to this story in your Bibles. You can use the Bibles in the pew, page 865, so we can receive God's word with our ears and with our eyes. We'll hear from the narrator, we'll hear from Jesus, an official, and his servants, and then we'll hear from the sick man and the Jewish authorities. The Holy Gospel, according to St. John, the fourth and fifth chapters. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had changed the water into wine. Now there was a royal official whose son lay ill in Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went and begged him to come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Then Jesus said to him,
"Unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe."
The official said to him,
"Sir, come down before my little boy dies."
Jesus said to him,
"Go, your son will live."
The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and started on his way. As he was going down, his slaves met him and told him that his child was alive. So he asked them the hour when he began to recover. And they said to him,
"Yesterday at 1 p.m, the fever left him."
The father realized that this was the hour when Jesus had said to him, "Your son will live." So he himself believed, along with his whole household. Now this was the second sign that Jesus did after coming from Judea to Galilee. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there is a pool called in Hebrew Bethesda, which has 5 porticos. In these lay many invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he'd been there a long time, he said to him,
"Do you want to be made well?"
The sick man answered him,
"Sir, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me."
Jesus said to him,
"Stand up, take your mat, and walk."
At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was a Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man who had been cured,
"It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful for you to carry your mat."
But he answered them,
"The man who made me well said to me, 'Take up your mat and walk.'"
They asked him,
"Who is the man who said to you, 'Take it up and walk'?"
Now the man who had been healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had disappeared in the crowd that was there. Later, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him,
"See, you have been made well. Do not sin anymore so that nothing worse happens to you."
The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. Therefore, the Jews started persecuting Jesus because he was doing such things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them,
"My Father is still working, and I am also working."
For this reason, the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because he was not only breaking the Sabbath, but was also calling God his own Father, thereby making himself equal to God. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I got you. Thanks. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This is week 5 in our series, Famous Johns. We're exploring people and places that bear the name John in one form or another as we read through the Gospel of John to better know Jesus Christ. This week, our famous John is Johns Hopkins Hospital and School of Medicine, which are part of Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland. Anyone ever been to Baltimore, Maryland? Anyone ever been to Johns Hopkins Hospital? All right. Well, a little bit of background here. Johns Hopkins was a faithful Christian of the Quaker tradition. He was a city merchant, a banker, an entrepreneur, and a philanthropist. Through his faith, Hopkins viewed his wealth as a trust from God to benefit future generations. Upon his death, he left a bequest of $7 million, which at the time was the largest philanthropic gift in U.S. history. He left this gift with clear instructions to form a university with a hospital together. The university was founded in 1876 and is ranked among the most prestigious academic institutions in the world. It's the oldest research university in the U.S. and has revolutionized higher education by integrating teaching and research. The university has since led all U.S. universities in annual research expenditures. Johns Hopkins Hospital was founded in 1889 and is widely regarded as one of the world's greatest medical institutions. For the last 32 years, it has ranked in the top five hospitals in the U.S. For 21 of those years, it has been number one. Johns Hopkins' vision of integrating medical research and medical education with the practice of medicine was revolutionary. The hospital and its School of Medicine are considered to be the founding institutions of modern American medicine and the birthplace of numerous famous traditions, including rounds, residents, and house staff. Many specialties were formed at the hospital, including neurosurgery, cardiac surgery, and child psychiatry. The Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine was founded shortly after the hospital in 1893 as its research-intensive medical school. It was one of the first medical schools in the country to admit women from its founding. It is the home of many medical advancements and contributions, including the introduction of gloves to provide a sterile environment during surgery. Johns Hopkins Hospital honors the healing power of Jesus Christ with a marble statue called Christus Consolator, Christ the Divine Healer. It is a depiction of the resurrected Christ with scars in his outstretched hands. The inscription below is from the Gospel of Matthew, the words of Jesus saying, "Come to me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The hospital says, "Every day, countless prayers, blessings, and thanksgivings are made at the feet of this awe-inspiring sculpture. People come and touch the statue of Christ as they seek faith, hope, and healing. They leave flowers, pictures, and prayers at Jesus' feet." William Spence, a committed Presbyterian Christian who gave this gift to Johns Hopkins Hospital in 1896, said this, "I thought it might help to comfort some sad and weary ones and lead their hearts and thoughts up to the everlasting divine healer who alone could give that rest." Jesus Christ is our divine healer and our great physician. Johns Hopkins Medicine is part of the profound healing legacy of Jesus Christ and the Christian Church. According to Mike Aquilina, early church historian and award-winning author, the hospital arose as a Christian institution, utterly dependent on Christian principles. Dr. Gary Ferngren, former professor of the history of medicine at Johns Hopkins Hospital, has said this, "The hospital was, in origin and conception, a distinctively Christian institution, rooted in Christian concepts of charity and philanthropy. There were no pre-Christian institutions in the ancient world that served the purpose that Christian hospitals were created to serve." The church invented the hospital. Jesus' early followers immediately took up Christ's directive and mission to heal the sick. With a sense of charity and compassion, many of Jesus' followers provided health care to the poor and to the sick, making use of the best resources of their day. Within a matter of decades of Jesus' resurrection, the church had developed systems for caring for the sick and comforting the dying. It was the Christian church that developed public hospitals after Christianity was legally allowed in 313 AD. Christians sought to add hospitals to every town where there was a church. Within 100 years, hospitals were everywhere, many of them founded and run by women. Wherever the church went, hospitals were built there too. Hospitals arose through a belief in charity, self-giving love as a share in the life of God. Inpatient medical care, in the sense of what we consider a hospital today, was an invention driven by Christian mercy. Hospitals across Europe were run by religious communities of monks and nuns. They provided care and food for the sick, no matter what, slave or free, Christian or not, whatever their status or prognosis might be. Hospitals all had chapels and clergy staff to pray for the sick. Prayer has been a vital component of hospital care since its beginning. Today, the church is still the largest non-government provider of healthcare services in the world. All care and concern for the sick carries on the mission of Jesus Christ. Jesus sparked a movement of healing that has expanded to reach the whole world. Jesus Christ is our divine healer and great physician. Jesus was born into a world of suffering and pain, of sickness and discomfort. There was a great demand for healing, and healing was an essential part of Jesus' ministry. Jesus healed not only Jews, but also Samaritans, pagans, and even the occupying Roman enemies. At one point, he sent 72 followers out on a mission to heal the sick, and they had great success. The stories of Jesus' healing that we read today tell us a lot about Jesus as a healer. Jesus healed people with a word. People he never met, like the official's son, and people right in front of him, like the paralyzed man. Jesus healed when people asked for it, when they reached out to him, like the royal official. And Jesus healed people that he asked to heal, that he reached out to, like the paralyzed man. Jesus healed when people showed a lot of faith in him, like the royal official. And Jesus healed when people showed very little faith in him, like the paralyzed man. Jesus healed people any day of the week, including the Sabbath, when he wasn't supposed to do anything. Jesus just couldn't resist healing and caring. We also know that Jesus didn't heal everyone. As far as we know, he only healed one paralyzed man at the pool by the sheep gate out of the many invalids that were there, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. Why this one out of so many? We don't know. Maybe he was the one who needed it the most. And we know that the healing didn't last forever. That boy with the fever hopefully went on to live a great life, but eventually he died. And so it was with the paralyzed man. He was healed, hopefully lived a great life, and then eventually died. You see, Jesus' healings weren't an end in themselves. John reminds us that they were signs. They were signs that pointed to something else. They pointed to Jesus' love and power. They pointed to Jesus' intention to expand his healing ministry through his followers across the globe. Even more, these healings were signs that pointed to God's great work to heal the wound in the fabric of creation. Signs that pointed to the healing and wholeness that will be for all of us one day in the kingdom of heaven. Our Lord Jesus Christ is a healer. A healer in body, mind, and soul. Jesus heals not only our physical pain, but our mental anguish and our spiritual suffering. Jesus heals our fear and stress, our worry and our shame, and gives us peace and comfort. Jesus pours out his healing love on us, which gives us the strength we need for each day. Our Lord Jesus Christ is a healer in this life and in the life to come. Jesus is working today through medical teams, nurses, doctors, treatments, medicine, surgeries, chiropractors, therapists, nutritionists, counselors, friends, and healers of all kinds to bring us healing today in this life. And much of it brings us tremendous relief. And yet, Lord knows, our fragile lives on this precious earth will not last forever. And so by his death on the cross and his resurrection from the grave, our Lord Jesus Christ has opened for us the gates to everlasting life so that we, you and I, may dwell with him there one day forever in total wellness and wholeness. No more pain, no more suffering. Our Lord Jesus Christ is a healer in body, mind, and soul in this life and in the life to come. I believe in the healing power of God, in the healing love of Jesus for us, for you and me. And while we continue on this earthly journey, in the midst of our own mix of suffering and pain, of sickness and discomfort, we have three things to do in regards to healing. First, we praise God for healing. Every one of us has been healed time and time again. Just try to think how many things that you have been healed from headaches to backaches, from indigestion to ear infections, from fear to stress, through medicine, through hydration, through rest and nurses and friends and medical teams. When I was 24 years old, my appendix burst. I lived with it for several days after that. And my life was saved by an emergency surgery. And I thank God for my medical team and for that surgery. We praise God for the recovery that so many of us have had from car accidents and surgeries and emergencies. God is the source of healing and life. We praise Jesus for healing in all forms. Second, we pray for healing. Like the royal official, we ask Jesus to intervene and help. We pray for ourselves. We pray for people we know. We pray for people we don't know. And when we have no clue how to pray, we just lift them up to Jesus, like we often do with people on our prayer list. We lift them up to Jesus. We pray for healing for their bodies. And we pray for so much more. We pray for guidance and wisdom. We pray for strength and peace. We pray for God to bless their families and their medical teams. We pray that God's healing love will surround them and fill them. Often there's nothing we can do but pray. And prayer matters. Prayer is powerful. It changes us and it gives God more love and goodwill to work with in this world. When there's a need for healing, we don't need to hesitate to pray. We pray to Jesus for healing. And third, we trust God for healing. We ask for what we need, and then we put it in Jesus' hands. Thy will be done. Come, Holy Spirit. The royal official asked Jesus for healing, and he believed Jesus at his word, and he went on his way before he knew the result. And that's often where we live. We make our request, and we continue on our way, trusting the promise. We trust the promise that God hears us. We trust the promise that God loves us. We trust the promise that God will care for us. Sometimes our prayers are answered as we hope and in this life, and sometimes our prayers are not answered as we hope and in this life. But every time, through it all, we trust Jesus to take care of us today and forever, come what may. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the healer of the world in body, mind, and soul, in this life and in the life to come. We praise Jesus for healing. We pray to Jesus for healing, and we trust Jesus, our divine healer and great physician. Amen. Our song of the day begins with a prayer for healing. Let's rise as you're able and sing together.
Living together in trust and hope, let us now confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I invite you to please be seated for a time of prayer. Together we'll pray for the church, the world, all those in need, according to our prayer requests. For whom and for what shall we pray together today? All these senseless shootings, let's pray. Oh God, you are a great healer, and we lift up to you all those whose lives have been touched by violence. We're mindful, God, of senseless shootings in our world and in our area as well. God, we ask for your love to bring healing to this world. We pray against hatred and violence, and we ask for peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Okay, a teen just died in a skiing accident and a ski trip coming up. Let's pray for them. Oh, Lord God, we thank you for the healing that you bring into our lives. And at the same time, we grieve the loss of life. We ask your comfort and peace to be with all those who grieve, especially this teen who recently died. God, we pray that your wisdom and your protection would guide our everyday lives. We pray for safety for our youth soon to go on a ski trip. God, we pray that the day would be filled with joy and goodness in your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For those who are contemplating suicide.
For those who are contemplating suicide, let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of life, and we lift up to you now all those who struggle through life with chronic pain, with mental illness, with spiritual anguish. God, we lift up to you all those who are contemplating suicide. We pray that your healing love would come to them. God, use us, use this church to share hope with people who are hopeless. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Yeah. For Megan and for other victims of domestic abuse and violence, let's pray. Gracious God, we lift up to you those who have been hurt and injured by domestic abuse and violence. We lift up to you Megan and so many others, God. And God, we pray that your healing love would come to them and bring renewal and restoration. God, we pray that your hope would fill our hearts, your hope would fill our lives so that it would overflow from us into this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Yep, a young mother that we know. Let's lift her up as well. Oh God, we thank you for healthcare workers. We thank you for hospitals and doctors and nurses and healers of all kinds. And God, we lift up to you all those who are desperate and all those who are patients in hospitals. God, and especially this woman that Margaret speaks of. And God, we pray your healing touch to come into her life, God. We pray that we would see miracles in our lives, Lord, and that we would be part of your miracles. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we'll finish with our prayer commitments.
Merciful God, we come to you for healing in body, mind, and soul, in whatever ways you know that we need. We especially lift up to you these members of our church: Sandy, Katrina, Marjorie, Michael, Rose, Carl, Einar, Ken, Jeanette, Gina, Dan, and Joe, Susan, and Lucy. Wrap your loving arms around us all and show us how to love one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Christ Jesus, head of the church, raise up pastors to preach your word and administer your sacraments, deacons to serve all people and bear your gospel to the world, and congregational leaders to bring vision, vitality to your people. Grant us the grace to identify those in our midst you are calling, courage to name their gifts, and opportunities to gently nurture and support their discernment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray now in silence for our families. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. It's time for the children's message. My young friends, come on up. Let's meet together. If you've got a noisy offering, you can bring that too. Our noisy offering, we're going to buy cocoa trees for our friends around the world. We're going to plant some trees with our noisy offering. Come on up. Oh, that was a lot of noise. Good one. Nice. All right. I am glad to see you guys today. Welcome. Glad you're here. I want you to try to think of somebody who is sick or who has a lot of pain. Maybe somebody in the hospital or somebody you know, like a family or a friend. Think of someone who's sick. Just hold them on to your mind, okay? Hold on to them. Thank you. And then I want you to think about what we can do for them. Jesus wants us to help them. That's part of our mission as the church, as followers of Jesus, is we help people who are sick. What can we do for people who are sick? What do you think we can do for them? Any ideas? We can pray for them, absolutely. What else can we do for them? Yeah, maybe raise some money for them if they need some money for treatment or something. Yeah, we can bring them food. That's a great idea. Yeah, help them like with projects or whatever, assist them to do things. Sometimes we just need to sit with them, right? Maybe hold their hand. Maybe we just listen to them and let them talk a little bit. That's part of our job, is to help bring healing, to help take care of people who are sick. And just like you said, prayer is such an important part of helping people who are sick. Jesus says, pray for people who are sick and ask God to help them. And we just say, dear God, help this person feel better and take really good care of them. So think of that person again that you had in mind who's sick or in the hospital. And we think of that person and we say, God, help that person and help them to feel better and take good care of them. You know, praying helps us not to worry. Sometimes it can be easy to worry about people who are sick, but praying helps us not to worry. We just turn our worry into a prayer and we talk to Jesus about it. We talk to God about it. And you know what? Jesus loves people who are sick, and Jesus helps to take care of people who are sick. And I'm so glad that Jesus does. Thanks, friends, for coming up. Will you help share the peace of the Lord with me? Face out to a family and friends and put your arms out wide. Say it with me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. I invite you to turn to your neighbor and share a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. We invite you to give an offering to the Mission Ministry of St. John's. You can do that online, the drop box on the front porch, by mail, and the offering boxes are at the three entrances to the sanctuary. This week at our Soul Troop Ministry, Wednesday after school, I was particularly struck by the prayers that were offered. Some really wonderful Thanksgiving prayers. Thank you, God, for family. Thank you, God, for friends. Thank you, God, for toilets. Thank you, God. Oh, yes. Thank you, God, for love. Thank you, God, for Jesus. Thank you for church. And I'm glad that we can be a part of a ministry that is helping our children learn how to pray. Amen, Ronnie. Thank you. I invite you to rise as you're able, and we'll offer our lives to God through song.
Salvation and uphold me with your free spirit.
Thanksgiving for the gift of our lives, our offering shared, and the meal we are about to receive. Let us pray. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth.
and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The table is set. Christ is the host. Come as you are. Please be seated.
Lamb of God, you take.
Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in today and forever. Amen. Amen. Let's sing All Over the World.
Looking back through history, the people, they have always had.
love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.